growing large, at will, especially in the morning.
Could you demonstrate that for us now?
No.
A man who stood so tall, now so small.
I think I was definitely more morbidly curious about Zack Snyder's Justice League than actually wanted to watch Zack Snyder's Justice League. Zack was back and fixing his vision of Justice League after the admittedly obnoxious fan campaign we'll talk about shortly. News articles were coming out about how Zack wanted to release it in black and white in open matte aspect ratio with IMAX shots, which made no sense since it was set for release on HBO Max. The kicker, too, was that it was set to be a whopping 4 hours long. I thought Zack Snyder had gone off the rails, and the fact that Warner Brothers let him do all these things seemed totally unhinged on everybody's part. Look, Zack genuinely seems like a pretty good guy who's excited about what he's making, but I genuinely could not fathom his creative choices he was going for with this film. I wanted the most genuine experience possible, so what I ended up doing was hooking up my Xbox to a Christie projector at the movie theater I worked at during the time of this film's release, and I watched the film in the theaters. It was a pretty long sit, being 4 hours, and I remember being bored at several points, but at least I was getting paid to do it since I was babysitting an empty movie theater throughout the pandemic. Especially in a theater environment, this film is wildly long. Of course, I was using my Xbox so we could pause and go to the bathroom, but when the film meanders for 5 minutes showing Aquaman power posing underwater, I didn't really feel the need to pause. Long story short, my initial reaction was largely negative, with it being slightly better than Batman v Superman, but definitively worse than Man of Steel. Soon after the release of the Whedon cut, renamed Justice League by a lot of Zack Snyder fans, a fan campaign was started in hopes of seeing Zack Snyder finish his vision of Justice League. A fan petition gained 180,000 signatures, but even after that, releasing the Snyder cut seemed like a long shot. Fans similarly pressured Warner Brothers to release a cut of Richard Donner's Superman 2, which actually had very similar production issues to this film, with that version of the film releasing 26 years after Superman 2's original theatrical release, or the Richard Lester cut, in 2006 to coincide with the release of Superman Returns, which would be Superman's first big screen appearance in a few decades. So the petition wasn't actually totally unfounded and had a very, very minuscule chance of making something happen. Snyder also had been known to release new versions of films like Batman v Superman and Watchmen, both having much longer cuts, which often cleaned up the stories a bit, but perhaps made them a little too exposition heavy. The film became less of a pipe dream as actors and creatives who worked on Justice League started voicing their support along with others in the film industry and comic book creatives. A fan campaign to donate to suicide awareness and marketing for the film was created and ended up garnering a lot of money for both causes. Not all of the campaign was surely for the love of the film or to stop suicide prevention, because some of the fans ended up being pretty terrible, and from my own experience, a lot of these fans still prowl web pages and harass anyone who says anything negative about a Zack Snyder DC movie.
By fucking inclusion and diversity, fucking tick boxes, that I haven't got a clue what they're doing, haven't got a clue about the source material, they just want a forum to spout their fucking propaganda bullshit. Their vitriol, their poison, their fucking disgusting degeneracy. That's what they're doing. And it's sacrificing all these great franchises along the way.
Every boy's special lady is his mother.
The irony, of course, being that his film was made and he moved on to a new project that he seems excited about, Rebel Moon, plus they're giving him full creative control and franchise opportunity. So why people want him to go back to Warner Brothers to finish his universe? I don't know. Zack also seems like a really good guy. I don't think he would really co-sign these crazy cultists, but I digress. He seems to fuel their flames anyways all the time. Fans at one point started a campaign to sell the Snyderverse to Netflix. However, James Gunn responded to the campaign saying that neither Zack nor Netflix seemed incredibly interested in the idea after supposedly talking to both parties. I don't know if Gunn talked to Netflix, but I believe he was in contact with Zack about the concept since he worked with Zack in the past on Zack's breakout film Dawn of the Dead, so he probably has his ways to contact Zack, especially being such an industry figure these days. Netflix would probably have to fork over massive royalties plus production costs even if they wanted to do a Snyderverse Netflix film. Not to mention, the negotiation for such things would be hard, since 1. WB owns HBO Max, and 2. They wanted to refresh the universe with James Gunn. Eventually, Warner Brothers announced they would do a film with Zack Snyder, given around $30 million to complete his vision of the film. This included some reshoots, added scenes, and updated visual effects along with editing. The final sequence with Martian Manhunter originally had Jon Stewart, but Warner Brothers had other plans for the character, so then he considered Kilowog or Tamare, at one point even kicking around the idea of bringing Ryan Reynolds' Green Lantern into the scene, before just finally settling on using Martian Manhunter. The story of the theatrical Justice League and Zack Snyder's Justice League are pretty similar, even with the much extended runtime, but let's redo this real quick. Steppenwolf attempts to reclaim the Mother Boxes from Earth with help of his Parademon army for his master Darkseid, who attempted to take over the world long ago but failed due to the combined might of the Warriors of the World at the time. He saw an opportunity to do this again following the death of Superman, as that was seen as the only real threat to their plans. Bruce Wayne, now inspired by Superman and back on his own superhero ways, assembles a team with the help of Wonder Woman, though Aquaman and Cyborg are initially hesitant to join, but eventually they join with the team. They revive Superman, who comes back evil, but then he comes around and they fight Steppenwolf and save the world. And I guess Superman's alive now and all that. The movie fleshes out the characters, for better or for worse, over the theatrical cut, so let's go into their motivations. Batman takes it into his own hands to leave Gotham and more generally protect the world following the events of Batman v Superman and the seeming death of Superman. He tries to form a team based on the upcoming threat of Doom as predicted by Lex Luthor after he supposedly met Steppenwolf when he turned Zod into Doomsday during the events of Batman v Superman. Batman has transitioned from a nihilist that he was in Batman v Superman to a more powerful hero who wants to literally and metaphorically save the world from the oncoming threat of the demons. Superman is revived during this movie, and his love for Lois Lane helps him regain his confused mind after being revived in the weird Kryptonian swamp Lex Luthor used to turn Zod into Doomsday. My only question is, did I miss something in one of these movies? Zod and Superman were both dead. The only thing that helped revive Zod, or at least his body, was that he was merged with Doomsday's DNA. How did they revive Superman without him becoming a crazed demon monster as well? And if the Pit can just straight bring people back the way it did Superman, wouldn't it make more sense for Lex to revive the more easily controlled Zod to join him on his plans to kill Superman? You may say then, Zod would continue terraforming the world. But the world engine is destroyed, so Zod couldn't do that. But he could kill Superman and rule with Lex. Then Lex wouldn't have a totally unhinged monster that he couldn't kill following the death of Superman. If the monster could kill Superman, then it stands to reason that Lex would have a bigger problem on his hands trying to figure out how to kill that thing. Why not just kill Superman personally at that point if you're going to make a bigger monster that's harder to kill Superman that then you're going to have to kill? It doesn't make any sense, and this film only makes the Kryptonian ship reincarnation swamp even stupider. Superman also has his black suit in this version. In the comics, it was used since Superman lost use of his powers, or at the very least, they were very weak. Here, the black suit is just something Superman had because it looks cool, I guess. In terms of the Justice League versus this, I get why they went with the standard suit because it's not something that's really explained or necessary to the plot. He also came back at full power and didn't have the suit on when he revived. So saying it has the same reasoning as in the comics would be wrong. It's even further evidence Zack is more about stealing cool stuff from the comics and iconography over justifying things with actual story explanations. Wonder Woman is back and is less conflicted in this movie than the Justice League version. Here, she's down to revive Superman and is just kind of along for the ride, even supporting Batman's idea to revive Superman, which was a big talking point in Justice League between Batman and Wonder Woman.
I have to learn to move on.
Steve Trevor tell you that?
But they cut all that shit. She's just happy to be along for the ride. Yeah, Wonder Woman's kind of a non-entity in this movie. She's just kind of there for fight scenes. The Flash is here as well and stands fairly unchanged from the Joss cut of the film. In the film, Barry eagerly joins the Justice League and is sort of just the comic relief. This film does do more with the relationship with his father and has him be a little more concerned about breaking the rules of the Speed Force, so to speak, with Flash knowing turning back time or running at the speed of light to revive Superman in the Super Swamp was dangerous. Flash has a couple of speed scenes. The first, he is saving Iris, who happens to be passing by him at the time he has a job interview as a dog walker.
Were you here when I was forced out? Now my...
is very much a ripoff of the Quicksilver scene from Bryan Singer's X-Men Days of Future Past. He also has a time travel moment late in the film, which is a bit odd. I don't know how Barry has time to monologue while going the speed of light. I guess that's just how the Speed Force works in The Flash. I don't love that time travel and dimension crossing is so easy for an amateur Flash in this movie as well. And of course, this complaint carries over to his solo film. In the comics, it takes a lot to do that, and even then, it can kill him. See Crisis on Infinite Earths. He also needed the cosmic treadmill early on in the comics. Basically, this Flash is a bit overpowered, but whatever, I guess it works for the movie. Aquaman is a lot different than he is in his solo movies and the Justice League. Both versions see Momoa's character be more optimistic and goofy.
Ride ain't over yet.
My man!
This version of the character has sort of like a warrior's nihilism to him.
Dressed like a bat.
You're out of your mind, Bruce Wayne.
Which initially leads him to not want to join the Justice League before realizing pretty quickly.
You and the form a symbiont circle. What happens to one of you will affect the other. You must understand this.
We should know Karen.
This arc actually makes more sense with this version of Aquaman than the one in the core universe, which just said no for no reason. I don't really think it's a bad thing that the character is different in the later films, given the fact that in theory this was supposed to be Aquaman's first appearance, or at least first full appearance, but they ended up pivoting the character for the theatrically released films. Not a knock, if anything it makes the motivation a little more clear, so whatever. Cyborg is conflicted by the experiment that created him and is discovering how connected and powerful he is. I mean, he's fine, but this movie has the same Cyborg problem the comics has, and that is that Cyborg is a definitive Teen Titans character. His history is so entangled with that team, it's sort of what makes him interesting, is the interpersonal drama. I think when Geoff Johns rebooted Justice League for the New 52, they thought this shakeup would work. The New 52's concept for the Teen Titans was borderline terrible, and wasn't even really comprised of a lot of the Titans, and Iron Man was popular, so Cyborg could be DC's answer to him. The problem is, the relationship of the core Justice League members was so established, and Geoff Johns was too lazy to actually establish new ones for Cyborg, so even in the comics he felt like kind of a background character. This is something Zack Snyder was also too lazy to hash out when he made his movie, so he's just kind of in the background of scenes and has this weird subplot about how he's a human computer. Even the action doesn't use him very well. Why not just sub in Martian Manhunter or Green Lantern? Martian Manhunter plays sort of a mediator role in the Justice League, which could be a more interesting subplot if he was to bring the League back together after a conflict. Or perhaps he's on the other side of the Superman argument and thinks it's irresponsible to bring him back to life. Or Hal Jordan Green Lantern. He's best friends with the Flash, they're kind of a duo a lot of the times, along with him and Green Arrow, who might have eventually been established. He also kind of has a rivalry with Batman, which I think is pretty well portrayed in Geoff Johns' New 52 run for all the shit I give Geoff Johns. There are more angles than just a sixth member who sits there quietly and doesn't add anything to the dynamic, but adds like an hour of runtime on literally useless information. Kind of reminds me of when Finn went to the casino planet in The Last Jedi. Like, I see what they were going for. The problem is, if you take him out of the dynamic, what's the fucking point? But that's kind of the problem with Justice League, honestly. The film is so weirdly paced. The first act, which is everything before the team assembles, is 2 hours. 2 hours of characters dilly-dallying around the film. Some doing little, some doing more, but Act 1 is very long and very boring. Following that, there's about an hour focusing on reviving Superman, which is effectively Act 2. Finally, Act 3 is the final hours where they confront Steppenwolf. It's very odd. They don't have a lot of time to bounce off of each other as a team, that they're not just doing fight scenes. The two that do are Batman and Flash, with Wonder Woman chiming in a bit, but not so much. As I said, she's a pretty flat character in this film. For a movie that's 4 hours long, it's surprising they couldn't do much to actually create any sort of team dynamic in a movie about a team of superheroes. It also really shouldn't have taken so long to set up Aquaman, since his origin isn't really touched on, or the Flash, since he also didn't really have his origin touched on. Cyborg had his origin in this film, which I think would be fine if Cyborg was essential to the team or added anything in the climax. Ultimately, Cyborg's prolonged origin feels like a waste of time, since he never had a key role in the DCEU, besides in this one film and its theatrical cut. I don't even think he actually shows up after this. He might have showed up in that one Peacemaker scene where Peacemaker meets the Justice League, but that is it, if any other appearances. So that is our Justice League. The only other major side character who shows up occasionally, but just floats around like a leaf in the wind, is Lois Lane, who is saddened by the death of Superman, and she finds out she's pregnant. They don't really touch on that plot at all. She just has a pregnancy test to imply this, but the idea, I guess, was dropped. Supposedly, Zack had a plan in the long term, which would be to have this baby replace Bruce Wayne as Batman either like 25 years into the DCEU or after a theoretical time jump. However, the nightmare world kind of implies that Lois is the key to everything and that an injustice-like scenario happens. So perhaps the baby was actually meant to die and Zack is just lying? Who knows? It also brings into question how long Superman was actually dead. Assuming Lois got pregnant on the day Superman died, based on ovulation, there would be around 16 days at the longest before she realized she missed her period. Pregnancies can be detected on the first day of a missed period with a solid percentage of accuracy. However, by 21 days after a pregnancy, you can tell with over 90% accuracy. So, figuring Lois as a well-educated person, she'd probably know about these facts. She also seems to be physically healthy, so it's unlikely she has an abnormal period. My point of saying all this isn't to give you a crash course in the female reproduction system, but it stands to figure that by the time this film happens, Superman has been dead a whopping 3 weeks at the time of this movie. So Steppenwolf organized this invasion in 3 weeks after hearing the Superman death cry at the start of the film. Which was heard around the world, presumably less time since he was ready to fight right away. And if it's been thousands of years since Darkseid's last attempt at taking the world, why didn't he invade like 30 years ago before Superman arrived, or 10 years ago before Superman became a thing? It feels kind of odd to me that this movie takes place mere weeks after the first. The movie also kind of implies more time has passed. Lex Luthor was only in jail a few weeks. Batman became fully invested in his new philosophy instantly. It's bizarre. Also, I think this kind of undercuts Superman's death, like he only died 2 weeks ago. Perhaps this is to further the Jesus imagery, since Jesus was only dead for a little bit, I think.
Jesus died on the cross.
I don't know. I'm just kind of spitballing here. I don't understand why Zack would kind of undercut the power of him killing Superman so much. Makes it even more pointless. Steppenwolf is the final character, and Darkseid thinks he's a failure and a loser. Otherwise, he's just CGI villain guy. I think it undercuts his scariness when the film comes out and says, we beat his ass in the past and Darkseid thinks he's a loser and a clown. Why not make it so he's like Darkseid's best warlord or something? We get a brief view of Darkseid, who at one point stares down the Justice League and implies his impending invasion of Earth, but that plot is obviously never going anywhere now that the universe is wrapped up. I'm sure James Gunn and his new universe will do Darkseid one day, but in hindsight, he probably should have been the antagonist of this film. Though, with that said, how the universe went was an unpredictable disaster, so I get why they had a small villain to start, despite the fact that, as a movie, it really undercuts Steppenwolf, which I will in no way defend as anything but an undercutting of the conflict of this film, which is meant to be 4 hours long. I watched the black and white cut of this film for my second viewing. I did this so I could experience it the way Zack claims he intended, or at least how he thought it should be viewed after watching the theatrical cut of Justice League. He also made this movie open mat, or 1:33:1 aspect ratio, pretty close to like full screen VHS, essentially. I think this was probably inspired at least in part by The Lighthouse, an A24 film that came out in a similar aspect ratio and also in black and white, which was a cult phenomenon in late 2019 upon its release, just a tiny bit before Zack Snyder would start to fully put his new cut into production.
Beat our father, the Sea King! Rise from the depths!
You're out of your mind?
I think Zack wanted some of that critical acclaim the style of that film got. But while it works in an avant-garde film about two guys in a lighthouse, I don't think it works as well for a movie that costed hundreds of millions of dollars to create. Also, part of the appeal of the superhero and comic genre is the colorful costumes and excitement that comes along with that. Now, you can do black and white and change up that format a bit, but I don't think it really works in a Justice League alien invasion movie. And I don't think Zack Snyder could actually justify that with any reason why he decided to do that. The theatrical cut went too far with its oversaturating of the film, making it look very ugly. The standard non-black and white version Warner Brothers forced Zack to put out was okay looking, color-wise, a bit swampy like Batman v Superman, but mostly alright. The black and white goes too far in the other direction and looks odd for a movie about colorful superheroes. It also makes the many ugly CG shots stand out more, which I think is odd, and colorful lasers and stuff just look bad since you aren't really getting any of the vibrance of those lasers. I really enjoy black and white films. I don't mind experimentation with aspect ratios, but this really doesn't seem like the film to try this stuff. This is a big budget action film. Half the reason to watch for most people is to speculate, and frankly, the fight scenes having a weird aspect ratio added in post-production cuts off the sides, which makes it less enjoyable. Now, if it was shot on IMAX cameras and came to, you know, IMAX, I might be able to excuse the aspect ratio since it's fairly close to the IMAX aspect ratio. But even then, it's typically edited to fit the screen better upon home release of the project. Basically, it looks stupid here. Add in the supposed intended way to watch this film, which is in black and white, and the fact that this movie was only made available on home devices makes it very bizarre and pretentious. I did watch this movie in the theater. I just plugged in my Xbox, like I said, and I streamed it through HBO Max. While I couldn't watch it on the IMAX, it wouldn't really matter, since the film is formatted to simulate IMAX on a home screen. So even with that context, you aren't actually able to watch in full screen without adjusting the masking, and at that point, it's not even full screen, you just covered the borders and it's still projecting the ugly black sidebars, just with it casting to a curtain instead of a reflective screen, so it's a little less noticeable. Basically, Zack's IMAX idea doesn't work the way it intended. Not sure how it looked when this film had its very limited screenings, but if it actually looked good, it was because the aspect ratio was adjusted again for those screens theatrically. Basically, what we have is a really stupid IMAX simulator, and even that he fucked up since the aspect ratio is 1:33:1, not 1:43:1. But that could have only happened because he didn't actually film or edit with that aspect ratio in mind, but because he was trying to copy The Lighthouse, which was shot in 1x19x1. Mind you, all three aspect ratios look similar, but it's not the same, so his explanation rings pretty hollow. The film does have some cool shots, aspect ratio and color correction aside, though Zack's obsession with changing shot speeds is annoying, and pads the movie even further. Like, did these shots of Lois Lane walking in ultra slow motion through the rain need to happen? Let us go now. I feel like if I sped up the shots, then leave the filler shots like the newspaper, which is shot in normal speed to add some context to the film, at the same speed, the film has exactly the same effect on the audience. It just cuts 15 seconds out of the movie. He also speeds up Wonder Woman in this fight, which is right after the Lois walking slow-mo scene. And this may be cool to show the speed of the fight, but it's also jarring when much of the rest of the film is shot in ultra slow motion. The tone of this film is much different than the Justice League cut formed by Joss Whedon. This film tries to be a little more solemn, but unlike Batman v Superman, which is incredibly edgy, this film doesn't really have a very clear tone. It's just kind of action porn. It occasionally tries to be sad. Rarely does it have much personal conflict. It's honestly very odd tonally, and one I really couldn't get my head around. The epilogue, which is like 10 scenes long, has several setups and tone changes, and it's so hard to actually pin down, but we'll talk more about this soon. Not a lot of characters show up in this version of the film, but there are a few cameos we didn't get to discuss that Zack added back into the film. Ryan Choi in the comics was the fourth person to take on the mantle of the Atom after being introduced in Brave New World number 1 back in 2006. Atom has a strange lineage, starting with Al Pratt the Atom, was just a short, strong guy. Ray Palmer was the second Atom, and the first one to shrink in size. Al Pratt, meanwhile, would spin off into Damage and the Atom Smasher, two heroes who work with the Justice Society, but we'll discuss those characters later on in my Black Adam segment. Ryan Choi was featured briefly in this film, having worked with Victor's dad on the Mother Cube experiments, but recently transferred to work on nanotech at Star Labs. Martian Manhunter first appeared in Man of Steel as Kelvin Swanwick. However, Zack Snyder's Justice League is the first time the character officially appeared as the superhero, so I saved talking about him till we got to this point of the video. The character first appeared in a backup story in Detective Comics number 225 in 1955, and went on to become a major player in the Justice League, being their support character and their caregiver of the Justice League satellite. He would also occasionally be a field member and helped to create the group in the Silver Age, though this has been occasionally retconned out of continuity, most notably in the New 52, which this movie primarily is based on. Kelvin Swanwick is an invention of the movies, but I don't mind. In the comics, he'd parade around as John Jones, a human disguise, when he wasn't a superhero, based on his Mars names, John Jones, but spelt weird. Yellinger is the only named Green Lantern we see in the DCEU, which definitely wasn't the intention when creating the universe with a planned Green Lantern Corps movie, as I said all the way back during my 2014 Slate announcement part of the video. But when that fell through, DC, wanting to reserve Lantern appearances till later, Yelen ended up being the only one we see. Yelen is an obscure Lantern from the 10th century. In the comics, first appearing in Green Lantern Volume 3, number 19 in 1991, and was the Green Lantern in Sector 2814, which encompasses Earth. Being a champion long before Hal Jordan became the primary Lantern of that sector, he managed to destroy the Yellow Limitation in the Power Ring, but the Guardians feared his power after Yelen took over China and gave his Power Ring the weakness of wood. This allowed local villagers to kill him using wooden clubs to free themselves from his tyranny, and when his ring was sent off to look for a new host for Sector 2814, it ran into Starheart, which caused it to create a unique power ring. Centuries later, Alan Scott, the Golden Age Green Lantern, would find this ring and be able to harness the power of the Green Lantern. This retcon explains why the Golden Age Green Lantern was unaffiliated with the Guardians, as they created a new ring for 2814 and also why the original Green Lantern could not affect wood, which ties him better into the lore of Green Lantern and the Green Lantern Corps. In the film, Yelin was around in 3000 BC and helped defend Earth from the parademons before being killed. It's a shame we didn't get more Lantern shenanigans, since it's deep lore with tons of sectors and also being ancient, not to mention the multitude of color cores, living planets, and lore that goes pretty deep throughout the DC universe. Iris West appears for the first time in Zack Snyder's Justice League after being cut from the theatrical cut of the film. She's a longtime love interest of Barry Allen and the aunt of Wally West, the third Flash in the comics, as well as Wallace West, the temporary replacement to Wally from the New 52 that was retconned to be that he is cousins with the original Wally West. Iris in the comics dated Flash and shared their first appearance in Showcase number 4 before marrying Flash, dying, coming back to life, and remarrying the Flash after his second wife died. The Flash legacy is very confusing, so just don't think about it too hard. In the film version, she's also a feisty reporter, but never gets enough time to shine in either of her appearances, in my opinion. Tom Hulkenberg does the scores in this movie, and man, another score that just totally falls flat in this universe. The best music in superhero films should get stuck in your head and emotionally guide you to take a conflict more seriously. Music in this film should have emotionally manipulated the shit out of you, and also get stuck in your head. Look at the Avengers theme in the original Avengers movie. When that popped up during the Battle of New York, it was crazy. I know some people are in differing opinions, but it's so important, and in this 4-hour movie, music should be essential to keeping you interested, especially with a lot of these bloated scenes of padded exposition. David Brenner edited this movie, and we talked about him a few times. He was credited and pulled off the theatrical cut, but seemingly did this cut, which is nice. He's also credited on the recent Avatar, which was his final completed project before he passed away in 2022, sadly. That said, the editing here is very competent. I think the fight scenes are solid and the pacing makes sense for the most part, despite the fact that the film has somewhat annoying slow-mo and fast-mo stuff, and also some shots that linger on far too long. Brenner, for his part, edited a lot of movies. Like I said, his last project was Avatar 2, which comes in at about 2 hours and 45 minutes. So this was probably part him and part Zack attempting to craft his subpar superhero opus to be as bloated as possible. There isn't really an end credits stinger per se, but there is a number of scenes attached to the epilogue that in theory sets things up to happen in the future, with the epilogue essentially being tied to those films' conclusions, along with three distinct end credits-like teasers to show what Zack lands if his films continued with the DCEU. We'll talk about the three pseudo-end credit stingers first. The first shows Lex Luthor has escaped from prison and meets Deathstroke, who he tries to recruit to make a team designed to rival the Justice League.
Now, you volunteered to destroy the Bat free of charge. Why the pro bono work?
It's personal.
Whether or not this was supposed to be a filler movie between the larger movies, or whether this was supposed to be a filler plot point in the film where they presumably fight Darkseid before the Apocalypse Vision is unknown. This is also an end credit scene that they had for the theatrical cut. In my video on that, I forgot Zack also did this scene, so I think I said it wasn't in both, but this video is very long and I don't remember. But it is true that a similar scene did in fact get filmed by Zack. The second end credit scene jumps to another one of Bruce's nightmare dreams, a la the one from Batman v Superman. In this one, we see something of an odd Justice League that Batman has assembled in the world that seems to have been through an apocalypse brought on by Superman, following something with Lois, a la Injustice, probably. The main point of the scene, which features Mira, Cyborg, Deathstroke, and the Flash, is to have Jared Leto's Joker bounce off Ben Affleck's Batman. Is it absurdly edgy? Yes.
And if you cross that line, I swear to God,
before what, Bruce?
Kill me? You don't want to kill me. I'm your best friend.
It's just nothing goes anywhere. But if it did, this would be such a horrible idea for a connected cinematic universe. The edginess works for a fighting game like Injustice as a scenario to get these characters to go to blows, but I'm not really a fan of this as a plot device for a potential full film. Finally, Bruce wakes up from that dream of a possible future to see Martian Manhunter, who says Darkseid's on the way to Earth, and basically the events of the film were just the start. He also formally asks to join the Justice League. This scene is odd because it's like, why didn't you help when Steppenwolf was here? You did that weird scene where you met Lois pretending to be Martha so she would not lose hope that Superman would be reincarnated or some shit. My point is, where the fuck were you? Martian Manhunter also worked in the government as a top military brass, so you would assume that this would kind of be his cue to help. But retconning Calvin Swanwick into Martian Manhunter was a weird idea, since he was involved in the Battle of Metropolis during Man of Steel and didn't intervene in BVS either. Calvin is a character made up for Man of Steel. If I remember right, this was a weird fan theory that they snuck into the film. It's fucking weird. So the presumed plan for Zack Snyder's Justice League Part 2 would have been that the Injustice League comes to blows with the Justice League, which then Darkseid shows up and they beat him up, but then something happens to Lois that makes Superman evil, which causes the apocalypse. They never announced a Part 3, so I think it's fair to say the plan, based on what we see here, was just to chuck a bunch of shit at the wall for the second film and call it good. The movie is so long and frankly boring that when taking notes, it became much easier to write about the bad things than the good things. I don't really know what to say even. I mean, I suppose the action's pretty good. I don't know how much of it was in both cuts of the film, shot for shot, but it's fair to say the action's still solid. I'll also say Zack's coloring looks a lot better in the slightly less pretentious non-black and white cut than Joss's cut, including making the climax something that didn't burn your eyes to look at.
Son of a bitch. Come on, follow me, you damn insects.
I also think Darkseid is possibly the only good-looking CGI villain in the DCEU up to this point in the franchise, with the Hall of Fame of Shit being, of course, Incubus and Doomsday from the DCEU's earlier years. It's kind of a shame this movie is one of those films that got shot with sequels in mind that never made it to screen, because this film really suffers from a forgettable villain and characters with not that much depth. I mean, Darkseid could have been super memorable. Also, if Snyder had just led with Darkseid and this hypothetical film went right to release, then they could have beat Thanos to the punch a bit, being kind of the main comparable Marvel equivalent. Then, if they wanted to do the Injustice League, that would be a good ramp up. Then I guess the weird Injustice movie Zack wanted to make, which, why the fuck not, I guess, is so edgy, like Zack doesn't seem like a real person anymore, and no one wants to see that shit on screen, but whatever. Regardless, they went with Steppenwolf, who is kind of a shit villain, to be honest. I think the costume they picked for Steppenwolf was kind of neat, and he's more threatening and expressive than the theatrical cut, but goddamn does his face look squished and weird to me. It makes me prefer the version we got in the final theatrical movie. This one also looks stronger than he evidently was, because Justice League, once they defeat him and his army, just beat the ever-living hell out of him. Yeah, Steppenwolf sucks, and it adds to the idea that the sequel just wants to be so epic when the original feels a bit underwhelming. As once Superman is revived, the threat is basically over because Superman is so ungodly overpowered. One of this film's biggest problems is the pacing, which I touched on a bit, but brings this movie from mediocre to unbearable. For some reason, the film is divided into multiple acts. This must be remnant from when HBO and Zack flirted with the idea of putting out this behemoth in episodes like a miniseries. But the titles are pretty dumb and pretentious. Act 1 is called Don't Count on It, Batman, because Aquaman doesn't want to join the Justice League, I guess? Act 2 is called The Age of Heroes because it expands on the heroes, I guess, but the Age of Hero titles perhaps implies more than just like a few days in movie time. It's not much of an age. Like, you think of the Bronze Age, it's like 500 years. Plus, the ending would probably be more aptly called that, as the complete league isn't actually assembled until the final chapter of the film. This title is nonsense. Beloved Mother, Beloved Son is Act 3. I can't think of a reason this title was chosen again. It's nonsense. Who is the Beloved Mother? Who is the Beloved Son? Aquaman? Is Aquaman the Beloved Son? I don't get it. Whatever. Act 4, The Change Machine. I guess The Change Machine is the Mother Box, and this shows it's powerful a bit, so I guess this one makes sense, kind of, but is just kind of lamer than calling the chapter just like Mother Box or something. Part 5 is All the King's Horses, which is referring to the classic nursery rhyme Humpty Dumpty, when the rhyme says all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. I get it, they revived Superman, who I guess is Zack's Humpty Dumpty stand-in, but why didn't they call it All the King's Men, not All the King's Horses? All the King's Men sounds cooler, at least it implies the Justice League is trying to reassemble Superman metaphorically, and this would kind of make more sense in my opinion than All the King's Horses trying to reassemble Superman. But who cares, I guess, no one put thought into these titles, they're fucking dumb. Part 6 is Something Darker, which I guess refers to the impending threat of Darkseid, who the League briefly comes face to face with. So yeah, these titles add nothing. If we divide this film into a 3-act structure, which it follows perfectly, it divides the film a lot better. But even then, this film's cuts feel fairly arbitrary, as defined by Zack. The film laughably fails to actually understand the pacing of a 3-act structure. If we divide this film into a 3-act structure, which it follows, since the divides in this film feel relatively arbitrary, as defined by Zack, the film laughably fails to actually understand the pacing of said 3-act structure. This film is essentially just Joss's Justice League, but with a really extended and frankly boring introduction that could have been its own film. At least lengthwise, I wouldn't want to watch it, despite little happening of interest beyond exposition. Both relevant to the wider plot, some redundant exposition as well, and a lot that kind of led nowhere. Act 1 ends when Aquaman joins the team over halfway through the film proper. That is when the core League comes together. They fought Steppenwolf for the first time, and the team has a single goal rather than just all being strewn about the film. The rising action in the film should not be 2 hours long, least if not in a superhero film. And if you want your film hitting that mark, it needs to be cut back a little bit. Act 1, of course, isn't being helped by things like villagers singing about Aquaman for approximately 5 minutes. Why? Who the fuck knows? Probably like a weird hero worship theme or something he thought was badass? If I'm being more honest, what happens? The egregious slow motion, Aquaman singing, Lois slow-mo walking, padded explanations and exposition that's way over-explained for an action movie, it essentially feels like a slightly more well-done version of Joss Whedon's Justice League, with tons and tons of padding, which actually had me debating which I preferred, honestly. It's basically just the same film, but more boring. I guess it's not openly as flawed, moment to moment, but it's more confusing for sure and brings up way more questions, along with being painfully tedious. After the super extended rising action, we have Act 2, which follows the resurrection of Superman. This clocks in at around 55 minutes. His resurrection would typically be considered the midpoint, which is often where some spicy drama is stuffed. Here it's his resurrection and confrontation of the League, since he's still delirious and confused upon his resurrection after 3 weeks of being dead. This happens 3/4 of the way through the movie, though. Act 3, which clocks in at around 40 minutes, is the climax and some exposition about Superman's return, with the epilogue clocking in at around 15 minutes of bonus setup scenes, which feels way too long for me and went nowhere. Honestly, Act 2 and 3 are well paced, but a minimum of 45 minutes should have been shaved off the first act. It's just too much stuff packed in that really doesn't add any substantial amount of substance to the film. The film wants to be an epic, and I suppose Zack tries to set it up to be one. It just fails to really get there and actually end on an epic note. A lot of epics are the story of one person, or one goal for a group to accomplish. If it's a single person, the supporting cast often shifts to cover a passage of time. Ensembles have one key aspect, which is establishing character rapport and creating unique characters. Justice League really doesn't do any of this. The movie is so long that if you watched the first 10 minutes, fell asleep for an hour, and came back, you could pretty easily pick up back where you were and start watching again without it actually affecting your viewing experience very much. This movie is the most boring possible way to see 6 colorful superheroes fight an evil warlord and his demons from hell. I think there's such thing as too much style, and that kind of comes about here with the speed changes, the black and white, the length, the aspect ratio. It all feels like way too much, especially in a film like this, which is supposed to be a superhero epic. Zack also blatantly ripped off Quicksilver's run from X-Men Days of Future Past. He does a decent job, it's just not original. Also, playing the weird music and him being able to monologue while running is odd. Also, during Flash's run, the soundtrack playing weird music and him being able to monologue really long and dramatically while he's running is kind of odd. I guess he kind of does that stuff in the comics, but on screen it just looks weird. But I guess that's just something that's hard to do for anyone. The run also looks excessively dumb. Also, did I miss something? Why is there tension when the Flash has the power of the cube? They have as many tries as they need to revive Superman. All they're doing is dropping the cube into the water. Also, Cyborg is the living mother box, and he can't power another mother box? Flash says running so fast is dangerous, but it feels like other options can arrive. I also don't really get how the pool can revive Superman. I thought, like, it rewrote Zod's DNA to make him Doomsday. Wouldn't that happen to Superman as well? Also, there's some stuff that doesn't really make sense from a story perspective, like when Lois and Martha have a heart-to-heart, and seemingly for no reason, they decide, while filming, the Snyder Cut reshoots to add a part where Martian Manhunter leaves the room, and she turns into Martian Manhunter. I don't understand why Martian Manhunter did that. So he could intervene, I guess, so Lois doesn't lose hope as a reporter? But, like, why does he care that much? Also, why is Martian Manhunter's side story this, rather than trying to at all intervene with this invasion? Or at least give Batman a heads up? The choice to change the generic general guy into Martian Manhunter also causes a lot of questions, as we kind of addressed earlier about the Battle of Metropolis in the Man of Steel, and why he didn't intervene during Batman v Superman. It just doesn't make any sense. I also like that Zack wanted to expand the universe, so we see a Green Lantern, which may have potentially showed an approximation of what a Green Lantern would look like in the DCEU, but it also furthers my question I posed earlier. Why didn't they just include one of the many lanterns in this film? If not Hal, why not Jon Stewart? Or Guy Gardner? Kyle Rayner? Simon Baz? Alan Scott? Green Lantern is a super marketable character if DC introduced him. You know what could have saved some time in this film too? If Aquaman just joined the League after his initial meeting with Batman? Finally, I wish the apocalypse scene was cut. It is excessively edgy.
Then when I killed you, and make no mistake, I will fucking kill you. Then I do it slow.
We live in a society.
Batman's mask also looks excessively stupid. That's a problem in all of these movies, but I've always hated the Ben Affleck Batman mask, and it looks extra stupid in Justice League. He just looks squished and stupid. Also, where's Joker's tattoos? Did he get them lasered off? Or did he get self-conscious and just start covering them with makeup? In Suicide Squad, he has white skin. He still has white skin here. So, what happened to his tattoos? Also, the lasers usually just fade tattoos, so it'd be a long, tenuous project for him to do that if he wanted to get the laser tattoo removal. Or, I guess, does the apocalypse have an excess of face paint so Joker can cover his tattoos? Where are the tattoos? I guess the only explanation is that they were drawn on daily during the events of Suicide Squad, but Joker couldn't commit to his complex tattoos long term. It makes no sense.
We live in a society.
Upon rewatch, yeah, Zack Snyder's Justice League is bad. Not as bad as Justice League, but still very dumb and bad. A lot of the fundamental problems come from not really thinking things through and bloating the shit out of the plot. The things that I think sets this apart from Batman v Superman is while it's marginally less stupid, it sort of fails to keep up any sort of continuous energy, and I find myself frequently bored, which I was also bored watching BVS at points, but never to the extent I am during this film. I also like binging long-form TV shows and longer movies, like several of Akira Kurosawa's films, like Seven Samurai, Ran, or Kage Musha, which are all pretty long. Crime films like The Godfather or Goodfellas, epics like Spartacus or Lawrence of Arabia, The Lord of the Rings trilogy, The Good, the Bad, the Ugly. Long isn't inherently bad, but it can kill a film if it feels like it's wasting my time. And a 4-hour film that feels excessively boring and long, like a Michael Bay film, isn't really what I want. I think there may be a good 2.5-hour movie here. Not great, but perhaps good. The direction they went in was just too much. I suppose it is, at this point, the definitive version of the Justice League in live action, but I'm looking forward to the reboot, because they need to rethink the Justice League and put more thought into the story structure from this franchise, because based on what we set up here in the epilogue, I'm not sad this film never got followed up on. Zack Snyder's version of Justice League also came out on HBO Max, not unlike what happened to Wonder Woman 84. It didn't do quite as well as Wonder Woman 84 in streaming numbers. Again, it's hard to calculate exactly how much the movie made or what impact it had on HBO's overall streaming numbers, given streaming numbers are hidden from the public, though. The film costed an additional $70 million over the already $300 million, which is an additional $40 million over what Warner Brothers initially intended to invest on. So essentially, this movie, all said, between the Joss Whedon cut and the Zack Snyder cut to get here, costed $370 million. It's kind of hard to measure the success of the film. It did really well on Blu-ray, DVD, and 4K, and is definitely a cult hit. The film got a 72% on Rotten Tomatoes and a 54 out of 100 on Metacritic. It's praised as better than the theatrical cut. The directions and characterization of the League also was better than the original cut, but people found the film extremely bloated. Certain critics claimed the review scores and reception might be slightly inflated due to the nature of its existence and the underdog story aspect, which I'm inclined to agree with slightly. While I think it is definitively better than Batman v Superman, it definitely feels less like a film than Man of Steel, which it outperformed critically. Also, the potential of being mobbed by the Snyder cult is probably another reason critics were positive enough to the point that it got a 72% on Rotten Tomatoes. Well, on Metacritic, it got 54 out of 100. That is an unusual pair of scores, to say the least. Usually they're a little bit closer. If people generally like the film, it's unusual to have a 54 on Metacritic, but a 72% overall approval rating. Doesn't really make sense to me. Regardless of what the critics think, the Snyder fans got what they wanted, and we can now come together as a society and say that Snyder fans are almost annoying as Star Wars fans. The film was nominated for Best Superhero Film at the Critics' Choice Super Awards, but was beat out. It was also nominated for the Coolest Fight at the MTV Movie Awards, but was also beat. It's pretty safe to say Zack Snyder's Justice League was no award show darling.